Good afternoon, friends. You are welcome in this very special webinar. The title of the webinar is Non-Invasive Imaging of Coronary Artery Disease. Topic to be discussed and highlighted by Dr. Colonel M.L. Vera, who is a consultant and head of the Department of Radiology in Manipal Hospital, Dwarka, New Delhi. Dr. Vera is an eminent personality in the field of CT imaging of coronary artery. He is going to talk about what is the current perspective of CT in evaluation of coronary artery disease, and he will also highlight what is going to come in this area. This is ever advancing field, and we cardiac surgeon are getting benefit out of this technology. Now we are just waiting, can we intervene on the basis of information given by the CT to carry out coronary artery bypass surgery? That area is still not in horizon. I'm sure in coming future we are going to have advanced technology where we could be able to operate on the basis of CT findings. So we cannot do the coronary artery bypass surgery on the CT finding, but we are able to do a lot of other procedures based on CT evaluation, particularly the valve surgery. Early days we used to ask for invasive coronary artery evaluation, and now because of advancement in the CT, we could able to get the information and we can operate valvular patients who are 40 years or above, where there is a possibility of coronary artery disease solely based on CT findings. There are so many other diseases where we need a preoperative coronary evaluation, and their CT comes very handy to us. This is a procedure which is non-invasive, can be done on OPD basis, and patient is comfortable. There is no prick, just IV dye, which I am sure Dr. Vera is going to take us all the way. So let me thanks Dr. Vera for coming out and highlighting of non-invasive imaging in coronary artery disease. Dr. Vera, please.
Thank you, Dr. Mishra sir, for nice introduction. I am delighted. Today, I will be discussing about non-invasive imaging in coronary artery disease, the current applications and the future prospects. The current decade has seen MRI and MDCT as valuable imaging tools for effective evaluation and monitoring of coronary artery disease. Both MRI and MDCT have shown their ability to examine various structural and functional aspects of heart at a level of details that was not previously possible. Future prospects of MRI and MDCT in identifying and evaluating useful cardiovascular risk markers are in offering and needs to be explored fully. Now let's go to the MRI. MRI is a non-invasive, non-ionizing imaging tool for evaluation of heart and coronary arteries. Cardiac MRI is now considered gold standard for assessment of cardiac function and myocardial viability. Cardiac MRI is increasingly used to evaluate rest and stress perfusion and identifying myocardial ischemia and infarct with a degree of accuracy. Despite significant technological advancement, satisfactory imaging of coronary artery by MRI has not been effective. Let's take the MDCT first. MDCT is widely available non-invasive imaging tool for evaluation of heart and coronary artery. It assists in assessing cardiovascular risk factors like calcium scores, intracardiac adipose tissue, individual CR stress, provides unmatched morphological evaluation of heart in coronary arteries with excellent luminal assessment and characterization helps in effective treatment planning by assessing myocardial viability, non-invasive measurement of functional flow reserve, an effective non-invasive screening tool for safe discharge of acute patients in ED, that is to have a to rule out. Let's compare the risk assessment for cardiac MR and cardiac CT. Morality wide, cardiac MR is a non-invasive, whereas CT is an ionizing tool. Scanning time wide, MRI takes prolonged time, whereas scanning is very short. Scanning CV, cardiovascular risk classification, very poor, MRI is poor, so for calcium score, weight and AC is concerned. Cardiovascular from CT is excellent. Evaluation of coronary artery plaque characterization and assessment is good in MRI, but is excellent in CT. Evaluation of grafts and stents is poor in MRI, but is excellent in CT. Evaluation of myocardial contractility, cardiac function, myocardial perfusion, and viability is poor standard so far as MRI is concerned. What can be done in MRI? Non-invasive functional flow reserve is not possible in MRI. It is ideal tool. Non-invasive tool, MBC is an ideal non-invasive tool. Triple rule out for our MRI is concerned, or a triple rule out is only gold standard in emergency management. Let's see in point wise. To take various aspects of MRI and CT and compare it. Number one, ionizing, non-ionizing, CT is an ionizing tool, MRI is a non-ionizing. So for cardiovascular risk classification, CT is excellent, MRI is not possible. Structural assessment, cardiac functional contractility is possible in CT, but good MRI is excellent. Myocardial perfusion viability, good. MBC is good, it is gold standard in cardiac MRI. Coronary artery evaluation assessment is excellent. It is not so good in MRI. Stent and graft evaluation is excellent. MRI is possible. Non-invasive FFR is the modality choice now, non-invasive, whereas MRI is not. So overall, if you compare cardiac CT of outperformed cardiac MRI. Now let's see, I'll go in detail about the cardiac CT angiography, coronary CT angiography. Why it is so important? It is a non-invasive, widely available and safe procedure. A single data set provides multiple information. Like cardiovascular risk assessment, like coronary calcium score, estimation of atrial coefficient, assessment of intracellular carrying states, excellent vascular anatomy and morphology and plaque characterization with the same data set, evaluation of cardiac morphology, cardiac function, like myocardial contractility, ejection fractions are possible with the same data set, myocardial perfusion and CTFFR are possible in the same data set, and triple rule out in emergency situation. These are all possible from the single data set in MDCT. And let's go for the cardiovascular risk assessment. MDCT helps in assessing cardiovascular risk factors associated with atherogenesis like coronary calcium score, EB cardial adipose tissue estimation, and radioatherial shear stress. Calcium score is now considered as gold standard for evaluation of coronary calcium score and widely used for cardiac risk assessment. EP cardial adipose tissue, same way, a potential quantifiable risk marker for atherogenesis, and endothelial cell stress, a biomechanical risk factor responsible for atherogenesis. All three can be evaluated with the MDCT. Let's go over the calcium score. It is widely used based and calculated based on Augustine scoring protocol. Plays a relevant role in stratification of cardiovascular risk. Calcium score is significantly associated with major cardiovascular risk event. Let's note about the in patient of diabetes mellitus, the risks compared to general population are higher. In the same say 100 calcium score, if a normal population risk factor is 10%, in diabetes it will be 15 or 20% higher than this. Augustine, how it is calculated, reflect the total area of calcium deposits and density of calcium per voxel and calculated as cumulative unit. Like calculation based on the summation of units of plaque density per voxel agenda, say 130 to say unit 1, 200 to 299, unit 3, 300 to 399, unit 4, and above 400 Hounsfield in unit 4. So summation of all in the entire calcium is calculated based on this, and the total point is a total calcium score. Calcium, how the risk stress is done? Calcium score says 0 to 10 is minimal plaque load, very low risk. Here the predicted chance of cardiovascular risk event over 10 years is around 1 to 2%. Similarly, calcium score of 11 to 100 is mild plaque load, relatively low risk. Predicted chance of cardiovascular event over 10 years is around 2 to 6%. Score 101 to 400, moderate plaque load, intermediate risk factor. Predicted chance of cardiovascular event over 10 years is around 13 to 16%. Score over 401 to 999, high calcium load, plaque load, high risk. Predicted chance of cardiovascular event over 10 years is around 20 to 29%. Score over 1000, very high plaque load, very high risk. Predicted chance of cardiovascular event over 10 years is around 37% and above. So this is the various how we stratify the risk factors. This is on how we calculate the calculation. On the left side, we can see how we can take the various calcium and summation of this is the total calcium score. This is the zero, RT is absolutely free. Here you can see about 250 score. Here the focal calcifate, let's say the coronary, here the diffuse, about 1200 and above, diffuse dense calcification in the coronary arteries. There is all, as been shown, is a normal left main LAD. Here is a dense diffuse calcifications. Let's see the pericardial, epicardial adipose tissue, the EAT. EAT is a visceral fat and position between the visceral and parietal pericardium. EAT is biologically active organ and associated with atherogenesis. Higher incidence of cardiovascular events has been noted in individuals having higher EAT volume. Epicardial adipose tissue is a quantifiable risk marker in CAD. It forms about 20% of the heart mass and covers 80% of the heart surface. Optimal cutoff for epicardial fat thickness and pericoronary fat thickness are 6.8 mm and 13.8 mm respectively. Similarly, patient with CAD has higher EAT volume. It 151.58 plus minus 558.9% compared to normal EAT volume of 120.94 plus minus 81 cc in normal patients. So epicardial fat plays a definite role in the atherogenesis. It can be accurately measured and quantified with the help of MDCT. Measuring epicardial fat thickness, epicardial and pericardial is a simple way to assess it. Estimation of epicardial fat volume is a relatively complex procedure. It has a semi-automatic automatic methods are there. We have to have a software to optimize the volume. This is the coronary CT scan. This is the epicardial fat between the visceral and parietal pericardium. This thickness, this is the epicardial fat. And where the vessels are there passing through the interventricular septum, this is the pericoronary fat. So we can be measured this like it is 4 millimeter, it is 13 millimeter, these are within normal range. Now this is another how we get the epicardial fat volume. This is the, you have to parietal, visceral pericardium, you take it out. Then you have to compute it by software. That is how you get the total epicardial fat volume. Now let the endothelial shear stress. Association of endothelial shear stress with atherogenesis is well established now. Low ESS predisposes development of atherogenic plaque and their subsequent progression. Shear stress is difficult to measure directly in vivo. Current ESS measurement is dependent on invasive procedures like catheter angiogram and IVAS, followed by vascular mapping uses computational fluid dynamics. It provides accurate assessment of local ESS and helps in characterizing plaque. However, the invasive nature of the test limits its widespread use. Non-invasive measurement of ES can be done by using computational fluid dynamics if an accurate description of the vessel geometry is available, 3D model of vessels. Advanced MDCT technology with volume data set provides excellent 3D image of coronary arteries. Several studies have shown that MDCT provides accurate 3D model of coronary arteries, which can be used for CFD calculation and measurement of CAS. Now, these are the three-dimensional image of heart. This is the coronary artery in the left side. These are the only coronary shown. This is the wide view. This is the one of the coronary artery internal. So they give axial data, 3D volume data for CAS measurement. This is the various data showing. These are in Pascals. Up to normal value of ESS is 1.5 to 3. Beyond that is high and less than is less. So this is counted in the counts of Pascals. This is the left coronary arteries, various data, how it can be calculated and color map for the ESS measurement. Now, evaluation of coronary arteries. Various ways like anomalous original ports, like high takeoff, single coronary artery, anomalous origin of RCF from LM, LCX from RCN, LAD from LCH, various combinations are there. There's the anomalous left coronary artery from pulmonary artery, this is known as Al-Kappa, luminal ascendment plaque characterization, and evaluation of stents and graft. These are all possible with the same volume data set. Let's say this is one of the single coronary artery. This is the only from the right side, this is coming out, this is coming in front of the RVOT and going and passing to the left side along the internal septum is a LCX. And posteriorly the PDA is just going behind the apex and coming up along the internal septum to form the distal LAD and diagonal branches. This is a single coronary artery. This is a very interesting case of 48 years old woman had come with dyspnea only. Cath NGO they tried, they could not cannulate the left coronary artery, so CT was done. But I can see it's a very prominent coronary artery. Right RCA is very large and arising, left LM is not visualized. Next phase, you see LM is just originating from the pulmonary trunk. So this is a Al-Kappa, anomalous left coronary artery arising from the pulmonary artery. One of the very interesting case, young lady is a paramedical staff. He used to have breathlessness when he exerted a little more, and he used to have very high rate, was placed on metalog for long, but suddenly she asked for a CT angio. I did it. Now this is the findings. RCA is arising from the left main, and it has a course between the aorta and the pulmonary tract, between the two pressure chambers. So anytime any exertion, this artery gets pressed up, and she to get chest pain and displacement. This is also known as the malignant form of anomalous RCA. This is about the unmatched member. This is the normal. You see the detail of the coronary artery. This is the LAD. This is the diagonal branches. I have got this is the ramassing terminal. This is LCX. This is optus marginal. This is a much detail of the morphology. Here about the graph. This is the SVG to OOM. This is the lima to the LAD. The graph details are excellent with the CT scan. Now this is the case which has come with a stent, but some chest band CT scan was done. You can see a long stent in the RCA, you can see it. But in the proximal part of the stent, there is a thin lumen surrounded by hypodensity around the stent. You can see very well visualized. This is nothing but endothelial hyperplasia. This is the luminal assessment, how do we assess the lumen of the vessels, the excellent luminal assessment, and you can see the plaques, various eccentric plaques, there are calcification, types of calcification, luminal assessment, the percentage of narrowing, everything can be measured with the multi-CT, MDCT, and electrocoration, whether there is a vulnerable plaque or not, various characters, findings are there, vulnerable plaque, like it has got a necrotic central fatty core, or it is a napkin ring sign, or it has got a surrounding inflammatory changes, the inflammatory plaque, all these are considered as a vulnerable plaque, can be done with the CT scan. This is a normal CT scan of the coronary arteries, RCA possibility. This is of the dense calcification, very difficult to assess the lumen. This is the various plaques with luminal irregularity, very luminal narrowing. These are the plaques of the different, this is the plaque, this is the eccentric plaques, this is a you will say reactive pressure, this is a possible vulnerable plaque. That is how we can characterize the plaque load in the inter coronary arteries. is a very, very interesting case. It's a very young man. It's come with a repeated low-grade chest pain, and ultimately one day asked for the CT scan, coronary angiography. We have done the coronary angiography. See the amount of disease. This LAD, proximal LAD, there is a narrowing, there is a proximal LCS narrowing, there is a RCA narrowing, all together it's narrowing, multiple, all three major vessels are involved. This is the global view. Globe view, you can see this is the LN, this is the LAD proximal, this is the LCX involved, this is the RCA involved, distal RCA involved, and this patient, since it was a triple vessel DJ, went for the bypass surgery. This is how CTA and IVAS, how we can characterize the plaque. This can be color coded based on the density, so calcium, fatty core, a fibrous plaque, everything you can see. This is the same patient, this is not from my, this is from the literature. This is the CT angio and this is the IVAS, and characterizing the plaque almost similar to that both the cases, so it is as good as IVAS. So far, characterization of plaque is concerned. Myocardial functions, yes, myocardial functions, various functions like myocardial contractility, early systolic ventricular volume, early diastolic ventricular volume, ventricular ejection fractions, ventricular cardiac output, left wall muscle mass, early filling volume, late filling, everything is possible with the CT scan. So this is one of the how you can see the myocardial contractility. We can see the myocardial contractility of the aortic segment. There are many things that can be seen with the CT scan. So this is the thing how we can see the measurement of the various volumetric stroke volume, your ejection fractions, your left ventricular, right ventricular, everything, muscle mass, everything can be done. It comes in a graphical measure once you do it properly. Myocardial perfusion and CTA favor. Whether stenotic vessels merits treatment or not has been left to nuclear perfusion imaging or MRI perfusion study to assess the myocardial viability or invasive catheter angiogram based FFR measurement. This is the present status where we decide whether it is a what type of treatment. Recent studies on CT myocardial perfusion and non-invasive CT FFR have established their grounds in assessing myocardial perfusion and FFRCT non-invasively for effective treatment planning in coronary artery disease. This is the latest development. The core 3-2 European multi-central trial, they have carried out. The results are combination of CT angiogram and CT perfusion and similar diagnostic power to the combination of cath angio and SPECT MPI myocardial perfusion in identifying vascularized patient at 30 days, revascularized patient 30 days. CT angiogram and CT myocardial perfusion imaging has robust diagnostic accuracy for identifying patients with flow limiting coronary artery disease in need of myocardial revascularization. So this is all possible with the non-invasively with cut coronary CT angio as it is done with the invasive way in catheter angio. This is our image of the SPECT MPI and CT perfusion. This is a rest image. You see there is somehow there in the stress, there is a perfusion defect, there is a perfusion defect, the part is the SPECT MPI. CT fractional flow reserve, CTFFR, de facto study. This is done on the heart flow CT flow software. This is very well developed, and it's only limited to the worldwide approach, but there is no commercial availability of the software. Various multicentric trial has been taken out and found quite useful and quite accurate. The results are nearly 20% improvement in the ability to identify flow restricting arterial blockage over the use of CT alone, and more than a twofold increase in test sensitivity from 37% to 82% in arterial blockage of intermediate severity with no loss of specificity in diagnostic performance. So this is a great achievement, non-invasively, we have a CTA paper up to this standard. This is the comparative study I have taken from the journal. So this is a CT angio CTA paper, this is the invasive cath angio paper. So you see, this is LAD, you can see 0.62, here it is 0.65, almost similar. Same here, it is 0.87, it is 0.89. RCA. So almost FFR is equal as per the at par with the invasive procedures. So this is excellent tool for FFR. Evaluation of chest pain in emergency department. Coronary CT angiogram is gaining ground as a fast non-invasive chest pain screening tool in hospital emergency room because it has got negative predictive value of 99 to 100%. The advantage of this. Coronary CT angiogram is ideal in ED for quick screening of low and medium risk patients to rule out coronary artery disease. CT screening of chest pain patients help cut down healthcare costs and reduces hospitalizations. Various study reports are there. That is how with a single data set you can see the entire aorta. I have not taken the luminogram. You can see any or aortic dissection is there. You can see the entire pulmonary tree, who have a pulmonary thrombus or not, and you can evaluate the entire coronary artery system to see whether CAD is there. And fourth dimension is the pneumothorax. This is also common cause for chest pain. So all four things can be assessed from the same data set. So this is quite useful and now being widely used in the emergency department. Various study, the one CT state trial study. This is the computer tomography, coronary computer tomography angiography for systemic trial of acute chest pain patient to treatment trial, randomized trial. The results are coronary CTA. There are two protocols have been compared: coronary CT angiogram based and SPECT MPI based protocol. So coronary CT angiogram based protocol patients were diagnosed 54% faster than SPECT MPI protocols. Cost 38% lesser than the SPECT MPI based protocols. No difference measure advanced cardiac events in each diagnostic strategy. Lower cumulative radiation in coronary CT angiogram protocols compared to SPECT MPI protocol. So coronary CT angiogram based protocol is faster, more accurate and less costly than employing SPECT MPI based protocol in the evaluation of acute low risk chest pain patients in the emergency department. This is published long back. So to say, coronary CT angiogram is a novel imaging technique in cardiac imaging which provides a number of vital information needed in day-to-day cardiological practice, starting from diagnosis to therapy decision making and risk stratification for future prevention of coronary artery disease. Coronary CT angiogram is gaining ground as a fast non-invasive chest pain screening tool in hospital emergency room. Thank you. Have a nice day. Any question now?
Thanks, Dr. Vera. Great presentation. You have taken us as a diagnostic tool to helping the pain management, which is the new advancement. And we surgeons are definitely dealing with pain management and how quickly you are going to give us help by deciding whether the patient has got a dissection of aorta, patient has got a coronary syndrome, our patient has got a pulmonary thrombus. These are the things which always we have to keep in mind. And in a single shot, in a CT room, we get an answer in a no time. So this was the new horizon where we have to venture out. And we are already up to, but going through very judiciously and getting your help is going to take us surgeons in a different horizon. You have also talked about FFR, which is really important. And usually we used to see the CT as a two dimensional, but now we are seeing a three dimensional, which is based on, that's the only limitation. This is based on individual evaluation. You know, so the competence of individual who is actually evaluating the CT findings is very, very important. Here we have got a superiority over the conventional coronary angiography, which we see as a two-dimensional. And the CT is going to help us with the three-dimensional. And of course, this will add on to the FFR, which is really, really a boom for us. And of course, even for, there are certain situations where the invasive cardiologist may not be able to answer some of the queries regarding the severity of lesion. Now with this kind of invention and newer technology which is going to available. Weak cardiac surgeons are going to get their great help. Thank you. With that, I would like to encourage the people to ask the question, and Dr. Behra is available for that. Thanks, Dr. Behra. Thanks.